Stick drift complaints hit a fever pitch this generation. As controllers have gotten more advanced and expensive, it's become more absurd that the same cheap, defective parts are being used for the most critical inputs. Better technology has been available for decades. Sega was using Hall Effect sticks as early as 1996, but companies have shown more interest in monetizing this defect than fixing it. Until they were sued for planned obsolescence, Nintendo charged $40, basically the price of a new Joy-Con, to replace a stick that probably cost them 20 cents. Instead of upgrading the parts on their $200 gamepad, Sony had the sheer abundance of nards to create a new business selling the same disposable analogs for $20 apiece. If you want an actual solution to this problem, you have to turn to third-party sellers. Gulikit has been a major name in this field, making Hall Effect sticks for Joy-Cons as well as third-party gamepads. I've installed their Hall sticks and found them to work well, but my focus today is on their new TMR sticks, which extend the same benefits to the Switch Pro, DualSense, and Xbox pads. The stock joysticks these controllers ship with use two potentiometers, one for the X-axis and one for the Y. Inside of each is a carbon strip with a known resistance, which modifies the incoming voltage predictably as it travels from one end to the other. As the stick is tilted, a conductive wiper rotates across the strip and determines the output. The reading at a neutral rest should be set as the center point at the factory. The wear that normal operation inflicts on these strips means that resistance changes are inevitable, so the values at that resting point drift over time. Hall effect sensors measure the strength of a magnetic field instead. Tilting the stick moves a magnet in relation to the sensor, allowing for much less contact and wear between parts. The only wear left to worry about is between the plastic gears, which has rarely been an issue outside of the N64 controller. According to Gulikit, Hall sensors would require up to 2 milliamps of current if dropped into these circuits, which were designed to deliver only one. So instead, the new sticks use tunnel magnetoresistance. What's the difference?
I don't know!
But they deliver similar results with only 0.3 milliamps of power draw. Gulikit claims this reduces battery drain compared to stock. There is one big catch. The parts have to be soldered in. It's not a simple plug-in replacement like the Joy-Con sticks. What's more, those intending to use the Switch Pro on PC will have to do hex editing to calibrate them. That probably limits their appeal to experienced modders. I'll walk through the installation later, but first I'll show the results so you can gauge if it's worth the hassle in the first place. The stick caps have a similar ridged edge, but instead of an inset dome, they have a very shallow, convex top. The material is also more slick, giving less grip overall. I slightly prefer the originals in this regard. The caps can be removed and swapped easily, so if you aren't happy with them, you at least have other options. There's a metal collar on the stick post, which should protect it from grinding damage over time. It won't prevent wear on the circular gate though, and I still saw a lot of dust forming, enough that I saw fit to put silicone grease on the posts. Then again, this was on a launch controller that was already pretty worn. The feel of the sticks is a tad more fluid, with less of the gearing and bumping around the original sticks were prone to. Drawing a small circle without using the outer gate is easier on these. I noticed the same benefit when testing their Hall Effect Joy-Con sticks. In both cases, the feel is similar but just slightly improved. I installed the sticks on two Pro controllers, a launch model and a newer E revision. On Switch, the sticks were basically perfect. The center points were dead on, and they responded consistently to the slightest movements in all 360 degrees, about what you'd expect from a pristine new Pro controller. There's not a whole lot else to say here. The point of these is to avoid drift long term, not to alter the feel or action specifically. The fact that they are a tad smoother and may extend battery life is just a bonus. PC is a different story. I tested with every program I had, even some N64 utilities. The originals had error rates around 5-6% on the gamepad tester app. The final calibrated TMR results were slightly better in the 4% range, but getting there wasn't easy. The DualSense has good tools that should make it simple to get the sticks fully calibrated for use anywhere. The Switch Pro can't do the same directly. It stores two sets of calibration data, the one done at the factory and the user-created set. The user calibration will get priority on the Switch, but a PC will only read the factory data, which is no longer applicable. Better Joy for Simu can fetch the user calibration, but even then, it doesn't fully work on Windows. Plus, it bugs out with certain programs. So for PC use, you have to dump the flash memory and overwrite the factory data with the user calibration. Ideally, once this is done, the sticks will work on PC, but that wasn't my experience on either pad. The range was too short to deliver full diagonal output. At this point, you can calibrate on Switch again, this time with the user data serving as the factory base, and you may see an improvement, but I found I had to manually tweak the range values. Getting full range with decent circularity isn't hard, but if the center points are off, there doesn't seem to be a good way to correct them. The left stick on my newer Pro was great. The right stick was worse than default. On my launch model, both center points ended up worse than before. No amount of tweaking was able to change this. Despite listing center values, the Joy-Con Toolkit app didn't actually move them. It apparently adjusts some inbuilt dead zone position, and tweaking it only made the offset more pronounced. I made sure the fit to the board was even, going so far as to desolder and reseat the units a second time. So unless I'm still somehow at fault, there may be a stick lottery with these. The upside is that the centers should never drift further away from this point, but if they're off enough to cause drift from the start, that doesn't help much. Whether this will cause problems or not depends on the software, and generally the answer is no. I tested with the worst launch controller to expose any issues. Every emulator I tested behaved well with the sticks, even with their dead zone settings minimized. The Zelda recomp had camera drift until a 5% zone was set, but that's similar to the original sticks. Steam Input's default dead zones fully contained the center points, but for the sake of testing, I set them to minimum. Most games apply dead zones of their own that will still cover it. The most noticeable drawback is that tilting in some directions will generate a response much earlier than others. Returnal had major drifting at startup, but it was fixed by boosting the in-game zone a few clicks. But when I tried the reverse, restoring Steam's dead zones and setting the in-game ones to zero, the drift returned. If a game doesn't have built-in dead zones and doesn't respect Steam's settings, you could run into trouble. The only failed test was the GOG version of Metal Gear Solid 2. Raiden could only reach running speed going up and left. My newer model was better, but still slow in some directions. I confirmed that the sticks were hitting full range, even going beyond the test borders, but couldn't fix the response. Even here, I was easily able to bypass the issue by adding the game to Steam and using its input handling. I assume there is software that could be unplayable with these sticks, but I didn't find it in my testing. Gamepad support on PC has come a long way, and between Steam and other apps, you should be able to force these to work just about anywhere. I should stress that the Pro sticks aren't really advertised for PC use. The hex guides floating around Discord are a little patchy, and you're pretty much on your own if you try this. But if you're lucky enough to get a well-behaved set of sticks, or buy a few boxes and only use the ones that measure well, it is possible to get perfect results on PC too. The installation and hacking is a lot of work, but it only has to be done once and hopefully never again. And while it's more time-consuming than the Joy-Con mod, I wouldn't say it's harder. The Joy-Cons are so densely packed with components that there's nowhere to get a good grip, and their microscopic plugs and ribbons are really annoying to work with. If you can handle that repair, you can probably handle this. If it still sounds like too much risk, you're better off just buying a pad that comes with Hall or TMR sticks by default. The third-party options are expanding rapidly now, but if you want to keep the features and quality of your first-party device while averting the horrors of drift, these sticks do the job. The price for a pair is less than a single one of Sony's scam replacements, and it's very fair compared to the cost of buying a new controller every year or two. If you have the equipment and soldering skills, I'd recommend these. If you're new to this kind of thing, maybe try a cheap soldering practice kit first, as desoldering an ROHS board isn't a great place to start. Hopefully the next generation will finally see a movement towards electromagnetic sticks, so that these kinds of products and mods become obsolete, but for the time being it's great that at least someone has a real solution. I won't be narrating the guide portion because long COVID is kicking my ass, and everyone just thinks I use text-to-speech anyway, so bon appetit. But first, I will say that Narrow Corporation accepts no responsibility for damage or injury occurring as a result of following this guide. Opening your controller is a violation of Nintendo law and will void your warranty. Hex editing mistakes may result in a bricked controller. Exercise caution to avoid health and fire hazards when soldering. Clear the area of pets, children, and elderly before working. Narrow Corporation is not a soldering expert. Consult further guides if you lack experience. This video should be considered a supplement to the official instructions from the seller, not a replacement for them. By proceeding, you waive all rights to sue the video author. Acknowledge that you are solely responsible for any loss of components, that Tears of the Kingdom was not very good, and that you are of sound enough mind and body to understand these terms.
Phew. Thank God that's over with. You'll want to have not only a soldering iron with temperature control but an exhaust fan for fumes, a heat-resistant mat, a good stand-slash-cleaning station combo, flux, clamps, and either a solder suction pump with a braid of wick, or a desoldering gun. If you want to stick with lead-free solder, be aware that it will need higher temps and be harder to work with. If you're not experienced, leaded solder is probably best. In addition to that, you'll also need common tools like tweezers, 90% or higher isopropyl alcohol, and a JIS driver set. Sizes 0 and 1 are needed. While you can get away with using Phillips, the likelihood of stripping a screw is much higher. The likelihood of me stripping is also high, as the YouTube revenue has dried up. Now that you have all of that shit, we can begin. The first step is to remove the screws on the grips using a size 0 driver. They pull straight off.
Next, the four silver screws holding the battery cover on. The cover should lift off easily, after which you can pry out the battery.
Wow!
Make sure to put this well out of the way of your soldering iron, or kaboom, ow, sizzle.
Now there will be 5 black screws keeping the controller halves together. Don't miss the 2 in the battery cavity. Don't! If you have a pick, running it along the seam can help pop the clips. Before separating the halves, be cautious of 2 things. There are adhesive pads on the haptic actuators that may keep the grips stuck together. Try to avoid pulling them all the way off.
There's also a ribbon cable connecting the circuit boards on each side that has to be unhooked. It's best to unlatch it on the bottom or analog stick side, so that it's out of your way when soldering. Flip the tab up and the cable should come out easily. The front, or button half, can be removed now. The joystick caps pop off with an upward pull. Next, remove the 4 black screws holding this board down. Unlike the exterior, these seem to be size number 1. The player LED should lift up and out.
With those gone, lift from the right edge of the board and pull towards yourself until the USB port is free of the housing. Carefully flip the board over to expose the solder joints. Top Sheila. In addition to the haptic wires, a stiff ribbon cable will keep you tethered. This one is soldered in place, but you can free it by removing the 3 screws on the small L-shaped board below. The gold screw is size number 0.
The next step is the only hard one, depending on the desoldering method you've chosen. The sticks are held in place with lead-free solder, which I couldn't melt reliably until setting my iron to 370 Celsius, yowza. Very high. I started by putting flux on each of the connections to aid in melting, and if it worked, I fired the sucker to clear the solder.
As you can see from the fumes, the fan for pulling exhaust is no joke. Get one. If a joint won't melt, add leaded solder to it. It seems counterintuitive to add more solder, but it will transfer the heat of your iron to a larger area. You bad boy. Doing this could let you get away with a lower temp and less oxidation on your iron.
Once the solder blobs were gone, I used a wick coated in flux to soak up the residue. You want to be able to see the through hole all around each pin. When you're close, you can gently, ever so gently, so sweetly wiggle the component and tell which pins are loose and which are not. This wasn't necessarily hard with the pump and wick combo, but it was time consuming. If you have access to a desoldering gun, use it.
Once the analog was out, I used wick again to clear the through holes as much as possible. You should also clean up the flux residue with isopropyl alcohol, even if using a no-clean flux. An old toothbrush is great for clearing every joint. Repeat this process for the second stick. You're doing great.
Fit a new analog through the holes and make absolutely sure it's fully seated. If it's not flat, you'll end up with range or centering problems that can be hard to resolve. Put flux on each contact to help the solder flow and reduce oxidation. If you're using leaded solder, be sure to lower your iron temp accordingly. If you have clamps, use them to keep the part uniformly tight to the board. The ones I had on hand were only able to fit around the button wing, so I had to resort to one-handed soldering.
While holding the stick down, get a small blob of solder on the iron and make a connection on one contact. Then, repeat the step with a connection on the opposite side. You may want to do this a third time for the wing of the stick where the button is located. If you do it this way, you may want to use a cloth as a buffer in case it gets hot. And it goes without saying that you need to be extra cautious about where your iron is and whether solder or flux is going to drip on you.
If the stick looks flat all the way around the base, then proceed with the remaining connections. As long as you're paying attention, this part should go quickly. Don't mess with me, man. The process is the same for the second stick. Once both are in, clean the board one last time with the alcohol. Son of a bitch. At this point, you should thoroughly wash your hands to prevent contaminating any of the outer parts of the controller with leak. When reassembling, start each screw counterclockwise until it settles into the old threads, then screw clockwise. Don't be stupid. Screw the L board back down and reinsert the USB-C into the shell. Replace the LED and the 4 goddamn screws. Push the new stick caps on fully. You don't have to apply silicone grease, but now is a good time to do that. While the controller is apart, it's also a good time to do the Scotch tape fix on the D-pad if you haven't already. I don't really give a shit what you do. Make sure the haptic wires are returned to their channel so they don't get crushed, and check that the haptic adhesive pads are in place. Reconnect the ribbon cable. It's tricky to insert it on this side, but you can completely remove it to make it more workable if you need to. Afterwards, getting it back into the button port side is easy. Squeeze the halves together until they click, and replace the 5 fucking screws. All day long I'm just screwing or getting screwed. Make sure the battery is replaced with the polarity matching the printing in the cavity. Before going further, connect to a switch and test that all your inputs are working. So move on to calibrating the sticks. I found that the menus couldn't even scroll before calibrating, so it's mandatory you do this right away. If everything works, finish by putting the battery cover and grips back together. Hold the grips tightly to the controller so there's no play in their fit. If you only use the controller on Switch, you're done. But on PC, you have to hack the goddamn calibration data.
This is done with a program called Joy-Con Toolkit, though be advised that this poses another risk of ruining the controller if you're not careful. Sync your Pro to PC via Bluetooth and open the app, then dump your SPI data. It will take a few minutes to complete. Find the bin file in the program folder, then create a backup of it to store somewhere else just in case. In fact, create backups of every major bin edit you do. You'll need to use a hex editor of your choice to open the dump. I found HXD to work well.
Well, now I guess I'm back because I can never catch a fucking break apparently. You need to find user data for the left and right sticks, which starts on line 8010. The left and right stick data is separated by several B2A1 blocks. Copy the 9 entries from column 2 to A. Scroll up to line 6030. Overwrite the factory data starting at column D going down to column 5 on the next line. Make sure you're overwriting and not inserting. Go back to line 8010 for the right stick, column D to 5, which gets pasted to line 6040 directly after the left stick data. A mistake here can brick your controller, so pay close fucking attention to the address. HXD lets you compare your edits to the backup file to make sure you know exactly what values you've changed. When you're done, save the file and open Joy-Con Toolkit again. Choose to restore your SPI, click Load, browse to the file you just edited and select Full Restore from the dropdown.
You should now have your Switch user calibration working in place of the factory data, where it can apply to PC. Test your stick results at the site in the description. It doesn't work on Firefox, but Edge was able to run it. The error rates should be lower than the stock sticks, but more importantly, your range should cover the entire circle. If not, games will have problems with the output being too low. If your range comes up short, you can connect to Switch again and repeat the calibration process, then dump the SPI again, redo the hex edit, and restore it to the controller.
If this still doesn't work, then goddammit, man, click the More dropdown in the toolkit and then let it calibration. Refresh all, then use the drop boxes to adjust the values as explained in the guide. Basically, raising the left column values will move the left and bottom edges outward, while lowering the values on the right will move the top and right edges outward. Isn't that what you want? I can never seem to do anything right with you. Working in increments of 50 is a good place to start for small adjustments. Click Right Cal when done. Then on the main screen, back up your SPI once again. You'll have to load the new bin into the hex editor and overwrite the factory values again and then full restore the SPI the same as before. On my Launch Pro controller, I had to repeat this process a dozen times before having the whole range covered, and while it yielded lower error rates than the original sticks, the center points ended up farther off, because of course they did, and best of luck to you in figuring that bullshit out. Changing the center value in the toolkit only seemed to move the dead zone, exposing the off-center rest positions in programs where they had been ignored before. What a treat. I want more of it. I hope it never stops. Thank you so much for watching. I am YouTube Nero, a clown for your amusement, a joke blowing in the wind to the ears of no one, a slave to an unknown algorithm, a beggar of digital affection. Play your stupid little game with your futuristic sticks. It won't change the inevitable outcome of your story. Feeding the soil and worms with your Dorito bloated form. Good night. All we have is love.